HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Cokie, A Life Well Lived by Stephen V. Roberts. This is the author. For Cokie, the love of my life. Introduction. What would Cokie do? Cokie died on September 17, 2019. A week after we celebrated our 53rd wedding anniversary. When I gave a eulogy at her funeral in the Cathedral of St. Matthew the Apostle in downtown Washington, my aim was simply to tell stories, some funny, some poignant, all personal, to illustrate her truly remarkable life. There were 1,000 mourners in the church that morning, but countless others heard the ceremony on TV, and the reactions I received were overwhelming. People were hungry for more stories about her, her origins and her impact, her generosity and her goodness. So that's why I decided to write this book. Cokie lived much of her life in public, by the accident of her birth and the choice of her career. Her parents, Hale and Lindy Boggs, both served in Congress, representing the city of New Orleans for a total of almost 50 years. The Speaker of the House, Sam Rayburn, was a frequent dinner guest during her childhood in the 1950s, in the home I still live in. And President and Mrs. Johnson came to our wedding in 1966 in the garden of that home. Many obituaries refer to her as the ultimate Washington insider, even as Washington royalty. But her professional success flowed from her own tenacity and talent, not family connections. She wasn't a full-time journalist until she was 34 years old, but she made up for the lost time, crashing through glass ceilings at NPR and ABC with her impressive mind, impish wit, and infectious laugh. The laugh, wrote Lear's magazine, distinguishes her from the self-important chin-tuggers of her trade, makes her someone people connect with. She loved hearing from young women who had followed her on the radio or watched her on TV or heard her at their school and said to themselves, I can be Cokie Roberts. I can be that smart, that confident, that powerful. Diane Sawyer, a colleague at ABC and a fellow graduate of Wellesley, once said, she made you brave. In another way, however, she wasn't royalty at all. She was accessible and approachable, a suburban housewife, as she often called herself, or an everywoman, as she told Lear's. People think I'm sort of sensible and like them and go to the grocery store and worry about tuition. But every woman didn't have her propensity for puncturing pomposity, especially if it came from a man, as it usually did, me included. Her ability to call foul on something that didn't make sense, it just endeared her to people, said ABC executive Bob Murphy. David Weston, who headed ABC News during much of Cokie's tenure there, put it this way. She was just Cokie. She knew the stuff. She knew the material. She knew it better than everyone else. And she would tell you what she knew, but she also had, and it sounds lofty, a moral compass to her about right and wrong that she brought to her reporting that stopped short of moralizing. George Will, who shared ABC's Sunday morning program with her for many years, mentioned Rune Arledge, who preceded Weston as head of ABC News and originally hired Cokie. Rune had this genius for understanding what felt good to viewers, and Cokie felt good. She just brought an ease and confidence and comfortableness. One of the things Rune understood was that television has you in strangers' living rooms, so you better not make them uneasy. And Cokie was a good guest in a stranger's living room. Then in midlife, she became a storyteller, publishing her first book at age 54, We Are Our Mother's Daughters, which reached number one on the New York Times bestseller list. Four other bestsellers followed, five if you include a children's version of one history book, all of which focused on researching and resurrecting the contributions women have always made to American history while seldom getting the recognition they deserve. As Catherine Algor, head of the Massachusetts Historical Society, told me, the biggest thing that she did was let Americans know there was a history out there they were not aware of. That just made a huge difference. There's one story that sums up what those books were all about. In Founding Mothers, which focuses on the Revolutionary period, Cokie writes about the enormous contribution Martha Washington made to the American cause, spending winters in camp with the soldiers and bolstering their spirits. And it really bothered her that the sign outside of Mount Vernon down the Potomac River from the Capitol read, "Home of George Washington," with no mention of Martha. As Mary Thompson, a historian at Mount Vernon, tells the tale, Cokie relentlessly pestered the director of the site to change the sign. Thompson usually drove into the grounds on a back road, but one day happened to pass through the front gate and saw that the sign had been altered to read, "Home of George and Martha Washington." Her reaction was to shout, "Yay, Cokie," because I'm sure that was her doing. "Politics is our family business," Cokie once told People magazine, and if anything, that was an understatement. Her first ancestor to serve in Congress was W.C.C. Claiborne, elected to the House from Tennessee in 1797 at the age of 23, the youngest federal lawmaker in the country's entire history. So her parents were part of a long and well-established tradition. Author Steve Hess counted 11 Claibornes, Cokie's middle name and her mother's maiden name, in major public office over seven generations, and rated her family as the second most prominent in American political history, outranking the Kennedys and trailing only the Roosevelts because they had two presidents. She really became a journalist by accident, mainly because she married one. When a Washington Post reporter asked her, "Did you consider entering politics yourself?" she gave this revealing answer. "Well, I certainly admire people who do it, but Steve and I met when we were 18 and 19. He was always going to be a journalist from the time he was like 9 or 10 years old, so it would have been very hard on him if I had gone into politics. I've always felt semi-guilty about it, but I've sort of assuaged my guilt by writing about it and feeling like I'm educating people about the government, how to be good voters and good citizens. And that's been true through my reporting, but also through writing these history books. I feel like letting people know what this country is all about and how it all happened is not public service." And then she laughed. Reporting the news and writing history, however, didn't fully erase her guilt. She wanted more latitude to espouse the causes she felt deeply about, and in 2002, at age 58, she quit her full-time job as co-anchor of ABC's Sunday show This Week. While she had many reasons for doing that, one of the most important was freeing her up to spend more time and energy directly promoting the welfare of women and children. She was diagnosed with breast cancer that same year, and while she had decided to leave the show before she got sick, her illness reinforced her decision to reorder her priorities. After a lot of research, she joined the board of Save the Children, the worldwide relief organization, and Charlie McCormick, who was then the organization's CEO, recalls meeting Cokie for the first time. She talked about her commitment to girls and women. It was pretty central to what she hoped would be her legacy. It was clear that was really consuming to her, a passion, and that's what we needed. I asked if she talked about her diagnosis, and McCormick, whose wife also had breast cancer, replied, "Oh, yes." She said, "I've got to rebalance my time because I don't know how much time I have left." Passion is the right word to describe Cokie's work as an advocate, and her value system was completely clear. Carolyn Miles, who succeeded McCormick as head of Save the Children, described those values. She was always standing up for women and mothers, and I think she felt as a mother herself that moms were the key. Not that she didn't care about fathers, of course she did, but I saw time after time that she was always pushing to enable mothers to have some knowledge and some capability to change the direction of their kids' lives. She really believed very deeply in that. So yes, through her visibility and celebrity, Cokie was an inspiration and a role model for innumerable women and girls. She was portrayed on Saturday Night Live, mentioned on The West Wing, pictured in comic strips like Doonesbury, and featured on magazine covers. She joked with Jay Leno, sang with Garrison Keillor, sparred with Conan O'Brien, balanced a pencil on her nose for David Letterman, and was the answer to numerous crossword puzzle clues. Many dogs and at least one dairy cow were named for her. In 1990, Spy magazine ran a drawing documenting all her connections and associations and headlined it, Cokie Roberts, moderately well-known broadcast journalist, or center of the universe. They were only half joking. But as I think about her legacy, I'm convinced that her private life was as significant as her public life. Few of us can be a TV star or best-selling author. Every one of us can be a good person. Everyone can learn a lot from how she treated others. Cokie did something for someone else virtually every day of her life, especially people who were not famous or wealthy or influential. I tried to capture that spirit in my eulogy. During the last days of her life, she was hospitalized at NIH, and when I would pull up, the valet parkers, all immigrants and not very fluent in English, would say to me, "We're praying for Miss Cokie." She became very friendly with one of her nurses, Letitia, and absolutely insisted that I rummage through her recipe box at home and find a recipe for crawfish cornbread she wanted Letitia to have. The author of that recipe, by the way, a man named Big Lou, is serving a life sentence in Louisiana's Angola prison, but he was Cokie's friend too. And then there was Judith, another nurse, who had two small children at home and was pregnant with a third. Cokie kept bugging her, "Judith, I want to see pictures of those children." And last Saturday, in the last hours of the last day that Cokie was conscious, Judith finally relented and showed Cokie pictures on her phone. Cokie's face just lit up with that incandescent smile we all have loved for so long. "Judith," she exclaimed, "what beautiful children." And the two embraced. That moment captured the Cokie I'll remember most, caring about someone else, helping them feel good about themselves, opening her heart and her arms, and making the world around her a better, brighter place. Through our long life together, we agreed that people learn best through stories, not sermons, through experience, not ideology. I've collected a lot of Cokie stories over the years, and I'll tell a lot of them here, but I also know what I don't know. There were important parts of her life that I did not share, starting with her female friendships. I was not there when she kept vigil outside a hospital room after a friend's cancer surgery, or when she flew to Massachusetts to attend the funeral of a friend's son, or when she counseled and consoled dozens of young colleagues about how to handle brutal bosses or benighted boyfriends. And I did not want to be the guy who tried to explain or interpret those friendships. I wanted her friends to speak for themselves, and when they do so in this book, many of them make the same point. Cokie was their moral touchstone, their guide to good behavior. As her childhood friend and college roommate Cinda Pratt Perlman told me, "Early on, I remember thinking, this is what I'm going to do. Instead of wearing one of those little bracelets that says WWJD, what would Jesus do? I'd have one made saying WWCD, what would Cokie do? Now we're talking. That's the real deal." That's why her friend Bob Murphy recalls sitting in the cathedral at her funeral and realizing that every person there thought they had a special relationship with her and were best friends. Then he asked himself, how does one person have the energy, the time, the bandwidth to have several thousand best friends? It's a good question with a complex answer. Some of those friends were men, of course. Cokie attended three different funerals for Bob's relatives, for both of his parents and his partner Pete. And he recalls, "To have Cokie feel and see and honor my relationship with Pete, that was a gift beyond anything I ever expected to happen." She deeply loved her male relatives, her father Hale, her two brothers. Tommy became one of Washington's most prominent loyal lobbyists. Billy died in infancy. Her son Lee, four grandsons, numerous uncles, cousins, nephews, spouses, and in-laws. She liked to say that the two of us stayed crazy nuts about each other for more than half a century, and in We Are a Mother's Daughter, she wrote, This book is about women, but it would not be possible without a man. To my husband, Stephen, my mentor, my fan, my lover, my muse, this book is dedicated. After Cokie died, many of my former students told me a similar story. They always noticed that when I talked about her, my whole manner changed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.